This week on The Wheelhouse. Housing. No one can afford it. What are lawmakers going to do about it? For Connecticut Public, I'm Frankie Graziano. This is The Wheelhouse. It's a show that connects politics to the people. We got your weekly dose of politics in Connecticut and beyond right here. Housing has been a hot topic during this year's legislative session. Connecticut just won a countless states with a housing crisis right now. Thousands of residents can't afford housing and the costs associated with it. The number of unhoused people is on the rise, and starter homes are increasingly hard to come by. Today, we're going to dive into the housing crisis, how we got here, and how lawmakers might help. Joining me now, two great housing reporters closely following this year's legislative session, Ginny Monk returns to The Wheelhouse. Ginny Monk, children's issues and housing reporter for the Connecticut Mirror. Ginny, thank you so much for coming on the show this morning.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, so glad to have you, and Connecticut Public's own housing reporter making her debut today, one of my favorite people, Abigail Brown.
Good morning, Frankie.
Good morning, Abby. All right, first question is going to go to Ginny. I just want to tell you, before I ask you that question, folks, give us a call, 888-720-9677, 888-720-9677, if you want to join us this morning. Give us some perspective, if you can. That's what we're looking for. We're looking for perspective. Ginny, what's the scale of the affordable housing crisis? Roughly how many people would you say are impacted?
Yeah, so the latest estimates from the Connecticut Housing Finance Authority show about 92,500 units of housing were short that number for some of our lowest income renters. And I want to clarify there that what that means is not necessarily that we need to build that number of units, but that folks are paying too much in rent. So there are thousands of people in Connecticut paying more than a third of their income to housing costs. And I think the other thing is that when we're talking about impacts on people, we need to remember that the housing market is really intertwined, right? So you mentioned the shortage of starter homes. Without starter homes for people in their late 20s, early 30s to purchase, they're staying in the rental market longer, which is just putting more pressure on the rental market. So we sort of see the ways the buying and selling and the renting are intertwined.
I think that's really evident in some of the work you've done, including the children's issue stuff. You really see the impact that affordable housing has on people that are into poverty. Abby, you've been reporting on concentrated poverty in Connecticut. Mm-hmm. Can you define that for us?
Yeah. So concentrated poverty is areas that are high poverty, low opportunity. So often these areas are lacking in job opportunities. There's a high unemployment rate. Connecticut, it's separated into census tracts, basically like, you know, neighborhoods. And Connecticut has 64 census tracts that are technically have concentrated poverty. Now, numerically, concentrated poverty means that 30% or more of the households in that neighborhood fall below the federal poverty line. So Connecticut has 64 neighborhoods that fall below that poverty line for 30% of the residents. And the area in Connecticut that has the most concentrated poverty is Hartford.
I was going to ask you that next. I appreciate that.
Hartford, and then they have 19 neighborhoods that have 30% or more. And Bridgeport is next with 11.
Wow. Any bills you think that are being introduced in this year's session to address this? And what stands out to you?
Yeah, so there is one bill that specifically is supposed to address concentrated poverty. It's a 10-year study. It has already been approved by the committee, and it'll now be for a full General Assembly vote. And basically, it is requiring these municipalities, these census tracts that have concentrated poverty, to provide a progress report next year, next June, if this passes. And then another report, final report, in January of 2026. And basically, the plan is to outline initiatives and ways to combat concentrated poverty. Part of the issue for the legislators is that some of the more conservative legislators are concerned, like, this isn't specific enough. It's like, are we sure it's going to really do anything? It's kind of just a 10-year-long brainstorming session. And some of the other legislators counter with, well, it's a step because we've been talking about concentrated poverty for years and nothing's really being done. So this is kind of the first real push.
And in the vein of Connecticut, a step is a task force or a study. That's funny. What's the relationship between housing and poverty?
It is pretty significant, I would say. I would say that homelessness in particular is a large issue that's on the rise in Connecticut. There are, on any given night, between 750 and 1,000 people sleeping outside. And strictly speaking, homeless residents in Connecticut, there are more than 3,000. And there's a significant chunk of those residents that are children or elderly is particularly on the rise because people, as Ginny mentioned, can't afford their rents, can't afford mortgages, and elderly people on fixed incomes are being priced out of their homes.
This is just a dismal situation. Hopefully there are some solutions. Maybe work, live, ride is one that lawmakers might see as a solution, a legislative session change that could be on the horizon here. What is work, live, ride, and how does it work, Ginny?
Sure. So work, live, ride is a zoning reform proposal that would largely affect towns with train and rapid transit bus systems. So it would encourage more density, more apartments, more shops. The goal is to try to build walkable neighborhoods around these transit systems so that people can walk to work, walk to a restaurant, sort of in short spans of time. And I think it's important to note, sort of just to add on to what Abby was saying on concentrated poverty, that sort of zoning, while it's really technical, affects so much about who gets to live where, right? And that has ties to health, it has ties to education, and it has ties to the social relationships you can make. If you're in an area of concentrated poverty, it's tough to make social relationships, network connections with people who are higher income than you. And we all, I'm sure, have experienced sort of what networking means for our life opportunities.
Could you tell me what, or maybe one town, or give me the idea of where we might see, like, as I'm trying to picture it in my head. For some reason, I'm seeing New Britain in my head. Where is a work, live, ride kind of a zone or a place?
Sure. So I think a good example would be Metro North to New York City, right? So a lot of towns in Fairfield County, New Haven, and what the bill does is prioritize these towns for certain state infrastructure funding if they are willing to create transit districts. So say, as of right, without a special hearing before the zoning committee, developers can put in multifamily homes.
New concept, or has work, live, ride been in the works for some time now?
Work, live, ride has been in the works for quite some time. It sort of falls under this land use concept called transit-oriented development, which is pretty broadly used in Europe. It's growing more popular in the U.S. It's a really big topic of discussion among land use policy wonks. And in Connecticut, we've seen sort of versions of transit-oriented development proposed every year from Desegregate CT since 2020. But the bill has changed a lot over those years, and even from last year to this, a lot of changes.
Any other housing bills that listeners should be paying close attention to this session?
Yeah, so I think the other sort of big topic that has people talking is some bills that would adjust the landlord-tenant relationship. So one that would prevent evictions when leases end, no-fault evictions, they're called. And sort of part of the point of that is tenant organizers, tenant advocates are saying they're seeing more and more people getting evicted under these types of evictions because the landlord wants to raise the rent. So we're kind of coming back to the lack of housing here with increasing rents.
So much pressure all the way around, like you said, on the rental relief market as well. 888-720-9677 If you want to talk to us, 888-720-9677. And remember, if you could share your perspective on the market, whether it's affordable housing or trying to get a house or rent, whatever it is, give us a call right now, 888-720-9677. I'm going to open this up to both of you. Jump in if you'd like. What's the likelihood that some of these reforms will actually pass, especially when we keep hearing that funding is an issue in other sectors as well?
Yeah, I think it's a good question. And another thing to remember is that we are running short on time in the legislative session. So sort of the further we get to the last day of session, the more power the minority has to just filibuster bills so that things don't pass. And like you said, funding is an issue. It looks like there won't be many changes to the budget. So sort of a few bills that we've seen, the homelessness bill asking for more money for the system, increases in funding for rental assistance, all of those bills with funding ties, it's looking less and less likely that they're going to happen.
So just to give people an idea of what the session looks like, it ends on May 4th. I believe that's the last day or that first week of May. Maybe it's May 8th. I forget. It's the first week of May or the first.
It's May 8th.
May 8th. Yes, that's right. It's the second Wednesday, actually, in May. So we have a holiday recess coming up. And then after that, there's only about 10 to 20 days left. So not a lot of time, as you said, running short on time. Before we had to break, Abby, you've been following the intersection between housing and environmental initiatives recently. Good yes. partnership we have with the New England News Collaborative. What are you reporting on right now and regarding the materials houses might be built with in the future?
Yeah, so I'm working on a story about the rise of mass timber in New England. Yeah, and a lot of people have no idea what that is. But basically,
what is mass timber, Abby?
It's a form of construction where wood replaces concrete and steel. So the big structural pieces are all wood. The walls and the ceilings are all wood, exposed wood. And it's a more environmentally friendly option, obviously, because it is a renewable source. So as long as the actual acquisition of the timber is done in an environmentally sound way, it is more sustainable. It's more on the rise in New England. It's very common in Europe and the Pacific Northwest. Our issue here is that there isn't really a framework for it. It's kind of a chicken and egg situation where more people want to see mass timber, environmentalists and architecture experts want to see mass timber, but there's no lumber yards that cater to it. There's no big complexes in New England to set the example of, you know, here's what can be done and it's feasible.
Chicken and egg, great metaphor used on your opening debut here on The Wheelhouse. You did a great job. Abby's story on the intersection between housing and environmental initiatives, part of a larger series put together between New England's top public media stations. Visit nenc.news for more information on the stories. Thank you to Connecticut Public's Abby Brohn, and go read Ginny Monk's stories at ctmirror.org. Thank you so much, Ginny, for coming on today. And you'll have more on the housing crisis, I'm sure. Thank you for coming on.
Thank you for having me.
And we'll have more on the housing crisis coming up. You're listening to The Wheelhouse. Join the conversation, 888-720-9677, 888-720-9677. This is The Wheelhouse from Connecticut Public Radio. I'm Frankie Graziano. We're talking about Connecticut's housing crisis today, how we've gotten into this mess, and what lawmakers plan to do about it. Connecticut, one of the most racially and economically segregated places in the country, with a long history of housing disparities. We're going to dive into why that is. I'm joined now by two guests, Anika Singh Lamar, clinical professor of law at Yale Law School. Good morning, Anika. How are you?
Good morning, Frankie. Thanks so much for having me.
Thank you for coming on. I'm so excited to talk to you this morning.
I'm very excited to be here.
Jackie Rabe Thomas, investigative reporter at Hearst Connecticut Media Group. We've sung her praises a million times on the show. You know I love Jackie. Good friend of mine. Morning.
Good morning. Right back at you.
You could join the conversation if you want, 888-720-9677, 888-720-9677. Anika, it's hard to talk about housing problems in Connecticut without having some historical context. So let's bring it back. Rewinding to the mid-1900s here. What was happening at that time that began laying the framework for some of the issues we got today?
Sure. Yeah, there are really two, I think, important trend lines, both having to do with how housing gets produced and how much housing gets produced. Zoning is a creature of the 1920s and 1930s, and it comes into being then, but it really takes hold as a restrictive force on the private sector's ability to build in the 60s and 70s. There's a lot of theories around why zoning across the country, but particularly in places like Connecticut, gets so restrictive in the 60s and the 70s. But the important thing for our purposes is that those restrictions drastically decrease production of housing during that era. And that happens to be at the same time, it's contemporaneous with efforts to desegregate the country. So as laws are passing to try to advance desegregation, local governments are really putting the kibosh on private sector development. And what it does is it freezes certain patterns in time. So here in Connecticut, we go from building 200,000 units of housing over the course of the 1960s, when the market was largely only available to white homeowners, to building fewer than 50,000, so one quarter of that number over the course of the 2010s. And that's a stark decrease in production as a result of zoning by the private sector. At the same time, beginning in the early 1970s, the federal government stops spending money to the same degree as it had been on publicly subsidized housing. So 1973, Nixon freezes housing spending. It never climbs back up to that number. And by the time we get to the late 90s, the federal government literally passes a law saying there will be no more public housing construction, something called the Faircloth Amendment in the late 90s. So we have a sharp decline then in public supply as well. And if you make it really hard to produce a thing, you're going to increase the price of it.
And as we covered in a past show on The Wheelhouse, we talked about the sand curtain in Connecticut and how that had a lot to do with this. The shoreline that we have in Connecticut, all the miles of shoreline that we have in Connecticut, and really only several miles of it is actually accessible. So go back to the archive, ctpublic.org/The Wheelhouse, to check out that episode. Inequity is what Anika's really talking about here. Jackie, you spearheaded a big investigation into housing segregation in Connecticut. Wondering how Connecticut differs from other states in the country. Is it fair to say that the disparities in Connecticut are worse than in other states?
Yeah, so if you look at numerous metrics, you know, pick one out of the hat and, you know, home ownership rates of Latino individuals, among the lowest in the country, Black families among the lowest in the country, largest disparities, not among the lowest. It never surprises me. It should, unfortunately, but when I'm working on a housing story, I'm like, Connecticut can't be the worst here, right? We can't have the largest
disparity.
And then
you went down to Westport.
right, yeah. And so it shows up in so many places of these disparities. You know, when housing's not built, it really limits choices for where so some of our lowest income individuals are able to live. And so it limits the communities where they're able to go to school. And that shows up in the tax base of what the schools are able to provide for their students. So it shows up in so many avenues.
I hate that my job is so macabre that I laugh about things like this, but I picture literally, I think it was you in Westport, where you go to these meetings and you talk to people. Are there towns continuing to fight against affordable housing today? And show us where we could still see this trend in Connecticut.
Yeah. I mean, if you look at any of the municipalities that are currently applying for a moratorium, it's not a discussion about how do we build more housing. It's about how do we build the very least that we need to get this exemption so that we don't have to be forced to build housing potentially. And so the conversation is always about how do we get to that sort of bare minimum so the state kind of gets off of our back or et cetera, and not sort of this conversation of how do we move forward collectively together.
Same towns that we've been talking about. If you were paying attention to this, since the late 1800s, really, it's same towns pretty much along the Connecticut shore that are doing this. How does, when you're talking about that moratorium, how does NIMBYism show up in housing across Connecticut? And what is NIMBYism?
Not in my backyard. There's also another term, banana, build absolutely nothing, never. I'm messing up the term. So, you know, there's, yeah.
Thank you, Anika.
Yeah, thanks for chiming in. My reporting chops are a little rusty. And so, you know, it shows up in so many avenues in communities, things like, you know, inclusive housing zones where communities say we're going to, you know, 15% of every housing development is going to have affordable housing component, but you dig in and you're like, oh, maybe that's actually a way to make sure housing never gets developed, right? And so, you know, or you only build efficiency units or one bedrooms and you realize, oh, that's actually so families aren't able to move into that community or don't have the same opportunity to move into that community. So it shows up in different ways, not necessarily always people saying we don't want families here or we don't want poor people here or working families here. And so it's, you know, you just have to kind of know the right questions to ask to see if it really is an inclusionary policy or not.
This is such a big picture question, and it kind of comes to mind now, and producer Chloe Wynn as well. We're thinking about this now. We talk about how Connecticut's the land of steady habits. Are we like this because of housing? Is this like a big reason why we are who we are today? Is like housing this fight and then this fight back, this issue with trying to have a moratorium? Is this what kind of slows us down? Why is this taking so long to fix?
Go ahead.
I can jump in. Jackie, is that okay?
Yeah.
I think that's a big piece of it. So we talk a lot about the Connecticut residents who are severely harmed by our current housing policies. But we also erect roadblocks to folks who might otherwise move here, who will then never move here because the housing is so expensive. So we are actually making our state less attractive, less dynamic, less interesting. We have literally frozen in time a vision of what towns looked like in, you know, 1951 or as some kind of ideal. And when you freeze the number of units that way, then not only are you going to inflate costs in an era of increasing population, decreasing household size, increasing desire to live close to major metropolitan areas.
You're saying that these towns that are opposing affordable housing, they're really hurting their own futures, is what you're saying?
Oh, for sure. I mean, I think there are folks for whom it is not an irrational choice to decide that they would rather have millions of dollars in home equity than have a dynamic, inclusive town. I mean, there is a shooting yourself in the foot, but there's also a very, very extremely selfish motivation going on here, which is that we have made people into housing millionaires because the thing that they already own goes up in value so long as they can stop other people from making more of it.
And then you have no housing stock, which people are worried about how expensive houses are becoming and the property values and things like this. And they're always saying, well, should I wait out the market? The market ain't going down anytime soon because of what you're just talking about right there, where people are just basically creating millionaires out of themselves by holding onto these houses. Jackie, you wanted to talk before we cut you off a little bit. What do you got?
Yeah, I was just going to say, like, look, if we're counting on the legislature to do something about the lack of available housing and that this housing crisis and building more housing and setting that pathway, look, Democrats have controlled both chambers of the legislature for 27 years, the governor's mansion for 13 years. And so, you know, they have the numbers to do this if they wanted to get it across the finish line. It just hasn't happened. And so I think in many parts of public policy, you see the courts intervening and you see decisions being made, sort of tipping the legislature's hand to say, you must do this. And so there is a lawsuit that's going on that will potentially, you know, draw the legislature into this reluctant conversation that needs to be had in the state of Connecticut, potentially.
Parties in the lawsuit.
The other thing I'd say, though, to that, Jackie, is that in other parts of the country, this has not been a partisan issue, right? So we see parts of the country like Montana, for example, where deregulating housing construction, liberalizing the zoning, has been spearheaded by a very conservative Republican governor. You know, Republicans in Connecticut have sort of put their heads in the sand, refusing to understand this as a deregulatory issue, but it really is. And you see places around the country where this is bipartisan, Republicans understanding that sometimes government goes too far and we overregulate things. And in this case, we've overregulated the construction of housing and underprotected property rights. And Democrats seeing that, you know, a lot of the folks that they care about and the issues they care about in terms of affordability are not being served by our current situation. You know, that has not been the case here in Connecticut, but it could be.
Very important national context there from Anika Singlamar. Thank you so much, Anika, for that. Jackie, that lawsuit, just really quickly, we're going to go to break soon. Who's in the lawsuit? What are the parties? When's this coming up?
Sure. So Anika actually helped with that lawsuit. It's her clinic. And so the lawsuit is in Woodbridge. They're challenging the zoning laws that I think it's like 98% of the land is zoned for single family use only on large lot sizes, meaning, you know, a duplex can't be built.
This is the 830G argument?
No, this is a, are the zoning rules restrictive? And so that case was filed almost 2 years ago, I think it's been. And so, you know, it'll be interesting to see how that plays out and if that has larger ramifications for the state's zoning policies.
Anika, I'm going to get your take on this right after this break because we have to take a break. Coming up, more with Anika and Jackie Rabe Thomas about Connecticut's housing crisis. If you're impacted by Connecticut's lack of affordable housing, want to join the conversation, give us a call. 888-720-9677. 888-720-9677. This is The Wheelhouse from Connecticut Public Radio. I'm Frankie Graziano. Jackie Rabe Thomas, investigative reporter at Hearst Connecticut Media Group, is still with us, as well as Anika Singlamar, clinical professor of law, Yale Law School. You can join the conversation if you'd like to. 888-720-9677. We're looking for perspectives today, if you can help us out with that. I'm just going to start off going back to Anika here. We were talking a little bit about a lawsuit involving the state of Connecticut here. Just want to make sure we got that right when we were talking to Jackie about it. What can you tell us, Anika?
Sure. So the claims in that case center around the zoning code in the town of Woodbridge and whether it complies with the state's Zoning Enabling Act. So, you know, zoning across the country is a power of the states. States can then, if they choose, delegate some portion of that authority to local governments. That's what Connecticut has done, but it's not without conditions. And there is a, you know, Section 8 of the Connecticut General Statutes. It's a long list of rules that towns must follow when they are adopting and implementing zoning codes. And those rules include things like you must anticipate, account for, facilitate, permit multifamily housing and economic diversity. And the argument is that the Woodbridge Zoning Code simply does not comply with that requirement inside of the, we call it the State Zoning Enabling Act, because it's the state statute that enables local governments to
Section
adopt
8, what number zoning. Is this?
Section 8-2.
Section 8-2 is because we see this a lot in reporting, and sometimes it seems like there's so much nuance to dig through. So this kind of helps our listeners. Like when you hear
there are other claims in that case that center on the Connecticut Fair Housing Act and the Connecticut Constitution. But I'll kind of leave it there. You know, fundamentally, the issue is that there are a lot of issues. You know, Woodbridge is a particularly bad actor in terms of, as Jackie pointed to, the percentage of its land area that is exclusively permitted for large lot, single family zoning. You know, Connecticut in general is much more restrictive than the rest of the country in terms of large lot, single family zoning. We have enormous swaths of the state in which you need 1.5 acres or 2 acres or sometimes even 4 acres to build a single family house. And nationally, the average lot size for a home is 1/5 of an acre. So you can build 5 or 8 or 10 houses on a lot that here in Connecticut will only let you build one. That is a huge driver of housing costs when you make things that restrictive. You could have single family, if you really love single family only zoning, which by the way, the original proponents of zoning thought was likely unconstitutional. I mean, the folks who wanted zoning in the 1920s thought that that was likely unconstitutional because we do have a constitution that protects private property rights. But if you're really enamored with single family zoning, it doesn't explain why you would insist that that single family zoning be 2 acres or 4 acres rather than 1/5 of an acre, which is the average size across the country.
Thank you for clearing that up for us, Anika. I appreciate it. Just pivoting here, we got a chance to talk to Pete Harrison from Desegregate Connecticut about their 2024 Work, Live, Ride proposal. That what we were talking about with Ginny earlier, promoting the development of housing near transit. We got to listen to a quick clip here from Peter. Then I want to hear your thoughts on whether it'll pass this session.
Despite a lot of the media coverage and noise, where there are definitely communities that resist doing anything, don't want to build homes and are very vocal about it, the more nuanced reality is that communities really do want to build housing, particularly near transit, just don't have the technical expertise and local staffs or commissions, and frankly, don't have the funding to build more sidewalks, water and sewer, and all those things.
Jackie, is this the nuanced reality that you see? I mean, are there towns that really do want money for affordable housing, or rather do enough of the towns here, maybe across America, want money for affordable housing?
I think there certainly are some towns that want to build around their infrastructure that is getting a lot of public funding to build that public infrastructure for trains and everything that comes around it. But I also think there are many towns that do not and are not interested. I've seen many proposals that are in a quarter mile of a train station or a bus stop, a main line, and they are fought tooth and nail. And so I think it really depends on the town. I think the conversation of whether this is the year that will get passed, I think Governor Lamont's made it pretty clear that he does not want to force towns to do stuff. He wants to take a carrot approach where try to give them money. I think research shows and history shows in Connecticut that the carrot approach has not been effective. We have about 2,000 housing units being built every year in the state of Connecticut. We have the lowest rate of housing per capita being built in the nation, period, hard stop, since 2000. Since the governor came in office, we're dead last still. So we are not building enough housing, and that has real implications for people. It means higher rent for the housing that is available for individuals. It means larger eviction rates when there's a housing crunch for lower income individuals. It means increased homelessness when there's a housing crunch. And it also limits people's choices of where they are able to live, where they're able to send their kids to school, and just really, a whole laundry list of not great outcomes.
There's the carrot approach, which is giving money to municipalities to kind of come up with housing. And then what's the other approach, being more forceful?
A stick saying, you know, the Zoning Enabling Act that Anika was just speaking about, you know, you can give towns the authority to affirmatively further fair housing. You can also take that authority away if they're not actually doing that, if they're not furthering fair housing goals and allowing individuals to live in their communities. I mean, if you look at the median household income, or even let's play something more simple of, you know, the average housing price, median household to buy a house in Westport is something like $1.5 million. I don't know about you, but that's not, you know, not a lot of people can afford that in the state, in your typical state. And so I think the demographics of communities are the new redlining, essentially.
And the great irony, of course, here is that a town where that income is required, where the housing prices look like that, can then with a straight face claim that they do not have the technical expertise or the resources to figure this out. You know, that's, I'm not a millennial or a Gen Zer or whatever. So I don't know if I'm going to get in trouble for, you know, using slang that I'm too old for, but this is weaponized incompetence. This is people saying, this is town saying, oh, we're so sorry. We just can't do it. We would do it, but we're just not that smart. And that is absolute nonsense. These towns find the resources to hire the consultants, develop the plans, do the things that they want to do, whether it's, you know, purchasing an island for tens of millions of dollars, or, you know, setting up a university scale laboratory equipment in their schools, whatever. Like, when they think something is important, they do it.
Land use is like local politics. Like, that's like the
biggest
thing.
They don't think this is important, right? And they're never going to think it's important. It's not just that the carrot approach hasn't worked in Connecticut. It hasn't worked anywhere. I mean, nobody can point me to a place in the country where this so-called carrot approach has worked. And in Connecticut, it ought to be really obvious why it wouldn't work, because these guys aren't worried about carrots. They're on to dessert. And they're laughing while they're eating their cake at the rest of us who are falling for this nonsense that all they need is a grant to hire a planner.
Hey, when we talk about bills like Work, Live, Ride, for example, do they make a difference for those most impacted by the crisis? That's what I want to get to. Or is this geared more toward working class and middle class? Not necessarily working class, but maybe middle class Connecticut residents.
If they're... Sorry, go ahead, Anika.
Okay, sorry. I'm not in the room. The solution in this realm, the solutions that help middle class and working class people also will help people in poverty. I mean, we have so little housing that you've got low-income people and middle-class people and even wealthy people competing for the same units. And when that happens, the richer people always win. So the more housing we can produce helps everybody. You know, I'm not really paying attention. I have not aware of like the specific negotiations behind the scenes on any specific bill. And it's important that we have bills that are trying to create more housing generally, including by creating the infrastructure, sewers, for example, to support more housing. But what we've seen across the country is that these efforts are successful in increasing affordability and helping the lowest income people and increasing opportunity when they, via sticks, eliminate overregulation. We've talked about Montana, places like Oregon. And when they set statewide expectations, enforceable statewide expectations for housing production, you can look at New Jersey, more recently California, Oregon. You know, those are the elements that make these bills, that would make these bills successful. Obviously, you also need robust tenant protections, and you need to fund the production of housing for the lowest income people. But those, to me, are the those are the criteria that I would look to assess, you know, whether a bill might actually help people.
Jackie, maybe this is a better question. Do you need to get the middle class involved? Do you need to get more of these people involved to get public support for a bill like this, rather than just going more towards the people who need it more? Some of these people that are in concentrated poverty.
I think that in general, having broader coalitions will help. I also think that those who work at the Capitol, their network is more of the middle or higher income class, potentially. And so, you know, people who are able to hang out at the legislature and spend hours or hire lobbyists to speak on their behalf, you know, I think is a it's potentially disproportionate to, you know, middle and higher income individuals. And so I do think you need broader coalitions for something to be successful.
Seems like a lot of legislation includes the words opt-in, where towns can decide if they want to increase the affordable housing in the area or not. Can we talk about the nature of opt-in laws, good thing or bad thing? And we only got about a minute and a half left in the show, but sorry for the pressure there.
Opt-ins. There was a study that just came out in the last couple of weeks that described a phenomenon that we all know is true, which is that homeowners, older people, people without children living at home, people who are white, people who are wealthy, are overrepresented throughout politics, but even more so at the local level, right? There is a structural reason why local government, there are multiple structural reasons that the demographics of who turns up and shows up in local government is just one of them. Why local government is so ill-equipped to deal with this crisis. The opt-in is, you know, just a way of, we're never going to get there with
Jackie, 20 seconds or here.
Sure.
If
you're talking about opting in, like, let's look at vouchers. Half of the vouchers that are being issued in the state of Connecticut are going unused because municipalities are making it difficult for people to be able to use them in other communities. They're not opting to make it so that people can use that voucher in other communities. They're not opting to increase the value up to 20% like the rules allow. You know, they're not participating in small area fair market rent, which would adjust the thing. So there are plenty of avenues that are currently available that municipalities are not opting into.
Jackie and Anika, thank you so much for coming on the show. Learned a lot. Appreciate you guys coming on. That's it for The Wheelhouse. Thank you so much for listening. Today's show produced by Chloe Wynn, edited by Meg Dalton, technical producer Kat Pastor. Thank you so much to Katie Pellico for helping us out in studio. My executive producer is my boss, Katie Tolarski. Download the Wheelhouse app anytime on your favorite podcast app. I'm Frankie Graziano. This is The Wheelhouse.